one of them is the pilot that I was in called Hand of God, and it stars Ron Perlman. Yeah, so he's the star of the show, and he's the judge of a small fictional I think it's scarier. Fictional California town, and he has some kind of religious experience where he's convinced that he's Solomon back on Earth, and that his judgment is flawless and all this kind of stuff, and starts to do these really crazy things. Exactly. And I play the district attorney, who's not entirely pleased with this attorney.
Yeah, the opening scene.
How many shows was
blindingly memorable?
I don't know. I just found out yesterday that we got picked up.
That's right.
They picked up one. They picked up one drama, which is us, and it was directed by Mark Forster, and that was really something to work with him because he did Monsters Ball and World War Z and Quantum Solace and a lot of great stuff. And then the other one was a comedy that was directed by Steven Soderbergh. So they really have pulled in some high-end guys to do these shows.
So you're going to have a recurring part?
Yeah. Yay! And as with all recurring parts, we'll have to see how recurring. If there's ever a contract down the line, that happens, as you guys know now. You're kind of out of the business right now, but as you know, they do that more and more to save money with pilots. They make more and more of the characters that probably should be series regulars.
Yeah.
They make them recurring for the first season, and then hopefully you hope that, if the show's a hit and they have more money, they put you on the contract.
Yeah. I just came back from Seattle yesterday. I did a Amazon pilot that's about what would happen if we lost World War II.
Oh, I read a breakdown about that. It's very interesting.
Yeah, it was based on the Philip K. Dick novel.
Oh, yeah.
And
half the country is controlled by the Nazis and the other half controlled by the Japanese.
Yeah, it's called The Man in the High Castle.
Oh, yeah.
And half of the country is controlled by Nazis, the other half is by the Japanese. And there's a neutral ground, like in Colorado, where all the freedom fighters and resistance fighters are coming to. And
sounds great.
It's a brilliant. The script is great, and I need to read the book. I hear it's fantastic. But again, like Tony said, it's a recurring role,
right?
Which would probably be a series regular role.
Right.
But I'm happy to be working, and it's a terrific project.
Yeah.
But Amazon, so many things are coming to this, right from your phone and your laptop and your tablet. Most of the stuff that I watch now is on Netflix or.
Everything's changing fast. It's hard to keep up with, even if you're in the business.
Yeah.
Because that's a lot of how things are being done now. It's this kind of direct content stream.
Mm-hmm.
And that, because people watch TV differently than they used to. Right. It used to be, hey, it's Saturday night at 8, Maddox is on, whatever the hell you're into. But you gotta wait. A lot of people, they wait for the whole season to be done and they watch it all once. This is all, this is really kind of started with shows, or really became in vogue with shows like Breaking Bad, because people were hearing about it, and then people would just binge watch, two seasons or something like that. And that can be a fun way to watch a show. It's like,
all the fun, none of the waiting.
You've got a Saturday you want to kill, you can just keep going to the next one.
Yeah.
Well, that's also because the networks cancel so quickly now. You don't want to watch a whole season and then it not exist the next season.
Exactly.
You need to make sure that it actually got carried before you start watching it.
Yeah, or they do like 10 episodes and then you have 6 months or however long, 3 months between, you have our winter finale, and then we'll be back in April or whatever, and then you got another however many episodes, and they never do a full season for a full season.
This show would have endured and been hugely successful if we were under this kind of contemporary paradigm. But we were under the old school thing of staring at the ratings every week and the numbers up a point, down a point.
The ownership
it always gets lunacy.
What it came down to was CBS didn't own enough of the show.
Right, they were working on a profit.
They took Eric and put him in that other show, it was Now and Then, put it in this time slot, and said, all right, guys, we don't own you, we're just distributing. So they weren't making enough money. Mm-hmm.
Right.
That was the main reason. Because the ratings were solid, and they had the fan base, obviously, just CBS wanted the whole piece of the pie.
It's all about money. They kept changing the night and the time, and so people would lose where Mag 7 was type stuff, and be like, well, wait a minute. So you guys have to sit down with your agents and do new business models for looking at these new streams?
Interesting point. I mean, I like I said, I haven't been doing it. I still produce some stuff, and I know a little bit of what Tony's talking about, but it seems that even though there's more programming being made and distribution sources, it's somehow more competitive and more difficult to book.
Yeah, and pay's way down.
It's never been easier to, someone said to me, it's never been easier to get something made, never been harder to get it to be seen. And everything now, it's getting harder and harder to get people to pay you.
Well, there's no quotes really anymore. It's, you know, your quote used to matter. It's like, that's the minimum they can offer you.
It was something that was respected. Now, everything, they'll put the breakdown out, and all of these roles, they'll get their couple of stars, all roles scale plus 10. And it's like, it's really inappropriate when you've been in the business 25, 30 years to say, that shouldn't even be, that shouldn't even be a precondition. They make it a precondition of your auditioning.
It's such bullshit. I mean, I did a movie, a big movie with Julia Roberts back in 08 or 09 called Duplicity. And with Clive Owen and Julia Roberts, Paul Giamatti, you know, all these big folks. And my audition was with the stipulation that I would have to be hired as a local out of New York.
That's
so my agent said, look, they're going to pay you shit. What are you going to say no? Because it's going to be, you know, it might be good for your career. So I did the audition. Tony Gilroy, the director, he calls me and says, you know, I would love to have you in the film. And I said, okay, great. He's fabulous. I said, okay, you know. So I had to fly myself to New York.
It cost you money.
I had to fly myself to New York. I had to put myself up in an apartment, and I had to beg for any kind of per diem I could get, you know? So pay
SAG. That's a big movie.
It's a big movie. I was on set for 9.5 weeks, you know? So that was the big, you know, I was happy to, of course, be working on this.
Yeah, but you know, it really does rob the joy of the experience because you're there, it's costing you money. You feel caught between a rock and a hard place. But that really is, it really is kind of flouting the rules of the Screen Actors Guild. They're really not supposed to do that. The fact of the matter is, you're not a resident of New York. You know, you're a resident of California. If they want you, they're supposed to fly you out business class, give you per diem, and put you up. You know,
but they don't have to anymore, because now, you know, B movie stars will take the leads in TV shows, and it trickles down, so suddenly if you had any kind of career in TV, very little left for you.
I just did a top of the show guest star on Castle.
Top of the show.
Funny enough, it was called Once Upon a Time in the West. I just finished 2 days
ago. Is that right? Now, those are really nice people.
Oh, great. Nathan.
Nathan and Stana are really, really nice.
They're both Canadian.
Canadians are all nice.
Are there any Canadians here?
Yes.
Where are you guys from?
Alberta.
Winnipeg,
that's right.
Calgary, Alberta.
Victoria.
Every Canadian I've ever worked with, you know, no matter how big a star, you know, whatever,
so nice.
Super nice.
We love you guys.
Castle a couple of years ago, and I was talking to Nathan, and he, at one point, he goes, can I get you something? Can I get you anything? Like, you know, press services or whatever? And I started laughing. I'm like, when are you going to start acting like a TV star? You know, why can't you be an ass like an American?
And working in Canada is just great too. I mean, it's just, it's just a different experience. You know, I mean, I love working. I was doing Battlestar Galactica for on
years?
And off for a couple seasons. And man, I had so much fucking fun. I would drive my dog up there and we would hang out. I would bring it to set. All the guys like, hey, buddy. You know, and I can't do that either. You know, here it's like, you got to go by the rules, you know. Leave the dog at home, you can't bring him online. You know? But, we love Canada. Australia, too. Any Australians?
But there's people from England. Your family's name?
Yeah.
What's your name, guys? What's your family's name?
Family name is Thomas.
Thomas has come all the way from England. This guy came from Wales.
From Wales.
If she had gotten any job, she'd be here from Ireland.
Yes, that's right. Yes.
What was that?
UK still has Scotland.
You can go.